Hey everyone, this is Joshua Kirk here with you once again. And now it's time for episode 94 of Album of the Day, in which, in honor of the Baltimore Orioles season that's going on right now, I'm wearing this shirt that has Manny Machado and Jonathan Scope, both those players on it. A couple of my favorite Orioles players, and I will admit that the Orioles are doing really well this year. I'm also kind of wearing this because I will be going to the game on Tuesday night, which will be fun. I'm here kind of, this is kind of a little shout out to, for me to support the Orioles, and, it's kind of a shout out to the Orioles, like the Orioles fans a little bit right here. Anyway, aside from that, let's get on to the review. So, today I'm reviewing pretty much actually the same artist that I talked about last video. A Minnesota folk pop singer-songwriter known as Mason Jennings. But I just kind of realized that he has so many other great stuff that I figured why not review two of his albums in a row for these two reviews. So, I'm here to talk about his 2011 album that was released in September of that year, and his third release on his own record label, known as Stats and Brackets. The album is called Minnesota, and I will say, I love this cover art. It definitely really does fit in with kind of the aesthetic of the music, and it definitely kind of looks like, a lot going through his mind right here, so I think it kind of fits in with kind of the aesthetic of the record. And it is named Minnesota, so it's named after his home state, but at the same time, it's not really about Minnesota or anything like that. I think it's really has to do more with his personal life down there or something like that. But anyway, this is what the packaging looks like. There's the disc. And there is it's like a poster going on here. Yeah, full of some beautiful artwork that makes up the really nice and very kind of panoramic and colorful album art. And there's the lyrics and the credits. And there are only 9 songs on this album. So it's pretty short. It's just about 30 minutes. And yeah, that's the packaging for Mason Jennings' 2011 album, Minnesota. So, this is again kind of a different record from his more acoustic stuff, but it's not in the sense of electric guitar driven, and it's not as dark as Blood of Man, the one I just reviewed last video. But rather, he describes it as a piano-based album, meaning there's a lot more piano going on this album than there is guitars. Even though guitar still plays a pretty significant role throughout the album. The lyrics are his life a little bit, it's kind of about growing up in Minnesota, but it's not really quite about, as I said, it's not really about Minnesota itself, really. Even though that is what the album title is. But anyway, let's just talk about the songs on here, shall we? The opening track on this album is a song called Bitter Heart, and this song really does show Mason Jennings's skills as a piano player. A really nice leading piano hook going on this track. And then, of course, it has lyrics, that talk a little bit about a relationship and, you know, and it's more like a, let me read some of the lyrics to see what it's really about. So it talks about how this person in his life, you know, has a light that kind of went underground a little bit, and he feels like he's kind of found it, and he's trying to tell this person that, because obviously this person, you know, has problems with, like, you know, he gets frustrated a lot of time. This person gets frustrated a lot of times, and he's just trying to get her to, like, you know, let go, and also talking about how she has kind of a stranger in her mind that, you know, wants her dead. Like, really just a beautiful and very heart-wrenching song right there. The next song on here is the undeniably catchy, almost Beatles-esque track, Raindrops on the Kitchen Floor, which has a really, just, you know, has one of the best, like, very, you know, playable hooks on the whole album. With, like, this kind of barroom piano going on, as well as this little touch of guitar that's in there, too. I forgot to mention, there's a really nice, like, string arrangement going on the track, Bitter Heart, too. Raindrops in the Kitchen Floor is definitely one of the standouts, because it has definitely one of the best hooks on the whole album. And then there's the track, Heart Stop Beating, which, kind of goes for more kind of a, this one has more kind of a rock feel to it. Like, it's one of the most guitar-driven songs in the whole album, but has a really nice, you know, electric guitar hook going on, too, as well as a really cool solo in the middle, too. And again, it does kind of talk about a relationship and talking about how, when the couple is apart, every time they're apart, you know, I'll have to maybe listen a little more carefully to, see what it's really about lyrically, but I do really like the hook on that song, like the guitar hook going on there. Then there's the track Clutch, which has a pretty lo-fi sound, because it opens with, like, sounds like, you know, a bunch of people, like, at a party or something like that, talking or something like that. And then of course coming in is, like, you know, the actual song, in the verses it sounds kind of like a, you know, typical, you know, piano ballad, but in the chorus it goes for more kind of a marching band feel with these very up-tempo drums, as well as a really nice, like, addition of horns, on, like, you know, the final chorus on there, which shows how, Mason is a very talented person in terms of, you know, how great of a lyricist he is, and he's such a great vocalist, too. He really can hold, knows how to keep the notes very well pitched, and also that he can play all kinds of different instruments, and he's pretty much playing more instruments than ever on this album. The lyrics on this song, it does talk a little bit about, you know, kind of a, troubled relationship a little bit, talking about how that there's, this ghost in his, life that, you know, just won't rest, And, you know, I think the, you know, noise of people talking at the beginning of the song really just fit in with, like, some of the lyrics about, like, talking your brother into buying us wine because we didn't have any ID. And, you know, I'm wondering, was it freedom that freaked us out or something like that? And talking about how they could live in a dream with, you know, kind of the strange things going on pretty much in this, you know, little, you know, really relationship. And he's also reflecting on being kissed so hard that both his front teeth were chipped and you know, all that stuff. So yeah, that's the song Clutch, and it closes with basically kind of the sound of, like, water waves, which I'm wondering if maybe Mason, you know, took, like, some sort of dictaphone recorder and, recorded sounds from, like, a famous ocean in Minnesota or stuff like that. That could possibly be the sound of the waves right there. Following that is the, like, you know, kind of psychedelic short track, which is Dream, you know, is driven by, like, this, you know, like, wailing, you know, string keyboard, along with this kind of, these, like, booming drums and, like, you know, some fuzzy guitars, in which, you know, to be honest, this is, like, the one moment on the album that, you know, this one would have to be my least favorite song in the whole album. You know, the reason for that is because, you know, I do like to listen to it from time to time. It's not a bad song, but you know, the thing that makes it my least favorite track is that it just kind of comes out of nowhere on this very piano-driven album. There's kind of this weird track that sounds like it would maybe make more sense if it were part of maybe a more electrified album by Mason a little bit. So just kind of doesn't really fit in with the rest of the album, you know, it's just kind of this strange little short, you know, psychedelic kind of filler moment that kind of, you know, comes out of nowhere on an otherwise pretty, you know, subtle and, you know, very piano laden album. Probably one of the best tracks on the album would have to be the sixth song on here, Rudy. It, like, takes, like, you know, statements of, like, stuff you'd probably hear in a classic fairy tale, and then he, like, uses it as a metaphor for, like, problems of the world in terms of, like, politics or stuff like that. So, like, you know, you're talking about how there's always that one, you know, person in politics who's always kind of taking everything away from us. But then, of course, you know, we have this really kind person that we kind of choose to elect in this world where, you know, just a lot of things are going wrong and, you know, and stuff like that. But then, of course, mentions a lot of stuff you'd hear in a fairy tale without it being, like, overly literal, without it being, like, literally kind of a fairy tale, even though they do mention about, you know, a mighty sword and someone's hand and the sword swinging, and like, chopping off the king's head or stuff like that. Musically, you know, it's probably the most acoustic song in the whole album, which kind of, you know, goes back to kind of the more acoustic guitar-driven stuff from, like, kind of the old days. Even though there is a little bit of a Beatles-y kind of tinge to it with the Mellotron and the Vox organ that occur at the end of the song. Like very Beatle. There's almost some very Beatles-y kind of arrangements going on this album. There's the song Wake Up, which definitely is one song dealing with a problem that Mr. Jennings has had in his real life. He talks about basically how when he was a little younger and started to play music, he used to, you know, drink a bottle every day and step on the stage. He finally realizes kind of his talks about how he used to have a drinking problem, you know, how he kind of realized something was wrong when he was half his age. Like, for example, one night when he was singing, he, like, wouldn't stop laughing for a week and a half in a chorus. And he did notice how other people were noticing it. Like, the girl in the front row saying, you know, that's not funny, that, you know, because there's something wrong with you. So, eventually he went to a therapist to talk about his problems, and he tells him, don't drink when you're nervous. Then he tries meditating, and then he goes to church and just sits there and stews. And like when he he's noticing that when he drinks, he starts to think things that aren't realistic. Like how can all these people believe things that aren't true? Like when he's sitting there in church trying to pray. But then of course he calls a friend on the telephone saying, I don't want to be an alcoholic. He starts to accept who he is, and then eventually realizes that, like, being yourself is being brave, and that you may not be a master, but you're definitely not a slave. So, like, because, you know, he kind of started out talking like a master, but living like a slave because, you know, too many drinks that he used to have. So I like how this song is a very smart sort of dialogue about, you know, the effects of drinking just to celebrate or something like that. For anyone who has had a drinking problem and then eventually quit. And went through pretty much every kind of cure possible to stop it. And then eventually found that stopping on it is a good thing. For anyone who's gone through that, this song I think would really connect to them. You know, unlike most songs about drinking where they're just all kind of sad, this is one that's like, kind of, you know, it's kind of sad and heavy, but then it has a happy ending. One track that really does see Mason really getting out of his comfort zone in a really nice way is the next track on here, Well of Love, which sees him doing something he's never done before. Basically, this is the one song that on a lot of the songs, Mason Jennings played all the instruments and sang all the vocals. But on here, he recorded this one with Adam Topol's band called The Living Room. And so basically, it's like him doing a vocal and then like the members of The Living Room providing some sort of mambo jazz kind of, you know, instrumentation. Like an accordion, a soprano saxophone, an upright bass, and just, you know, kind of a boatload of hand percussion. But I will admit, he does manage to create this whole kind of loungy thing really well with the instrumentation on here provided by The Living Room. And all I have to figure out what that song is about, but I do really like how the instrumentation sounds on here. And then it closes with the song No Relief, which again shows Mason's skills as like a piano player. It's like he plays some really nice, very correctly noted piano in the intro, the middle, and the end. And then on the verses, he kind of, you know, speeds up the tempo a little bit. You know, so this track, it isn't really about the lyrics necessarily, but it is just about being a really good, like, beautiful piano piece, and just, you know, and being a really great way to kind of close the album. Even though, you know, my My major gripes with this album would have to be that it's maybe a little too short because it's like just about 30 minutes and it's only 9 songs, so it kind of sometimes doesn't really feel like a full length album, as it does more kind of a long EP or something like that. And plus, you know, of course, the other gripe is the track Witch's Dream kind of seeming a little out of place, you know, in the middle of, you know, the rest of this album. But overall, I do think this is a really good album, and I think, you know, it really does show that Mason Jennings is really talented, you know, in terms of trying new things. Like, this is a particularly ambitious record right here. Or even though it's, you know, not as, you know, dark or as dramatic as a lot of the stuff, or thematic as some of the stuff off of Blood of Man. So I'm probably going to have to give this one maybe an 8 out of 10. The reason I give it an 8 instead of a 9 is because, you know, of course, I mentioned my only two lowlights for me on this album. But, you know, if you never heard this album but you really like Mason Jennings, I do recommend you check this out. And, of course, Mason Jennings did recently put out a new album on March 18th called Wild Dark Metal, which I definitely do want to get myself a copy of that pretty soon. Which I probably have to go to, like, Amazon.com for it because, you know, it's released independently and, you know, it can be pretty hard to find when it's just released independently on Mason's own label known as Stats and Brackets, even though, his albums are currently released on Stats and Brackets, but, like, you know, manufactured and, like, distributed by, 30 Tigers. That's my review of Minnesota. Great album. Highly recommend it. I'll see you for episode 95.